Obrigada. Boa tarde, gente. Tudo bem? Ótimo. My name is Jessica, and today I want to tell you about my crazy experiments into the way the brain learns through a project I call The Art of Why. But first, I want to know, how many of you consider yourselves curious? How many of you like to know why things are the way they are? Yeah, most of us do, right? Now, how many of you have ever wanted to ask a question but held back? Maybe because you thought it would be rude to ask the question or inappropriate. How many of you have held back on a question when you've wanted to ask? Yeah, me too. You see, I love to ask why. I love to ask why things are the way they are, why things are funny. I even ask myself why I like to ask myself so much questions. But it's just what I do. I've always done it. And now I get to do it for The Art of Why and through one of our sub-projects called Artism Awareness, which began with some home videos that I made of my cousin Savi, who has autism. Savi is 8 years old, and he wants to be a soccer player or an engineer, whichever comes first. He's learning things every day, and every day is a new discovery, or two, or three. And he's doing things that are so remarkable and so incredible that I can barely keep up. I don't understand why anymore. So I am left asking why. Here's a clip where Savi joins me in drawing on a notebook while I'm at the dinner table. He made many drawings that night. Many of them are not intelligible to the untrained eye. You see, in this project, Artism Awareness, I go around and I make art with children who have autism. And I always learn from them more than I teach them. It's very interesting the way that he draws. I don't know about you, but when I see these videos, I can't help but think of the brain and how absolutely fascinating it is. I want to ask you, did you know that our brains are not done developing until we are about 35 years old? That means that we could be making discoveries every day as well. But our home videos, they finish when we're what, teenagers? Which is such a shame because there's so much more learning to capture. Another silly fact about the brain, I have a friend, Julia, who had multiple concussions in college. And so now, once every hour, her brain has a hiccup. Every hour, she has a hiccup. And nobody understands why. None of her doctors understand why, and we can't. We don't even know what part of the brain is acting up to produce that. Another fact about the brain is that one in every 68 children have autism, and that's only an average. In America, one in every 189 girls are being diagnosed with autism, and one of every 42 boys are being diagnosed with autism. 42 is almost a class size here, right? These videos remind me that the brain is making all kinds of connections at any time, in any place, and often at uncontrollable hours of the day or night. Indeed, the brain works in funny ways that we still do not understand. But for lack of understanding does not mean we cannot document it and catalog it and talk about it. So I promised to tell you about my research experiment. Well, I want to map the brain's processes using big data. I want to document and navigate the brain's processes using anecdotes and experiences captured by everyday people like you and like me who want to know why. These big data sets would be manipulated through filtering algorithms that we've already begun to produce for audio and visual data, for heart rate, brain waves, and even skin capacitance data. It's going to be a lot of data, and it's going to be messy. But if we play our cards right, we can discover things about the brain that would have otherwise, a few years ago, been utterly impossible. Now, I'm an engineer from MIT, so I know the scientific method pretty well. But today, I am not talking about a hypothesis-driven experiment. I'm calling for community-led investigations. I want the community to be the researchers into the ways the brain works so that we can derive new knowledge about the way learning happens. It's simple. You learn more about the way the brain works, you know, learn more about the way teaching and learning happens. Then you know what your classrooms should look like in order to support that kind of teaching and learning. And of course, the better classrooms, the better we grow as a society. It's easy. You just have to be, so how do you do this, right? That's the next question. It's easy. You have to be curious and curate. Now, many of you, yes, that's a word I made up, by the way, curate. I totally made that up for you today. How many of you have ever posted a photo or a video on social media somewhere? Yeah, absolutely. In the moment where you are deciding what to capture, what caption to put on the photo, what title, what to share, what not to share, what angle, in that moment you are curating something. Now, have you ever posted something that you made, your own picture or your own words and thoughts? Yeah. So that's called creating it, and together you would be curating. Voila. Now, there's more to it. You can't just curate. You also have to ask why. A lot. You see, for this experiment to be successful, we need data, and we need it to be as interesting as we humans are. Think of these curators as a sort of con artists. This is a different kind of con artist. Here, there's a K, and it's silent. These con artists are everyday people like you and like me that ask about the brain's connections and aren't afraid to ask why. They understand context, they value observation, and they know how to synthesize information into knowledge. I teach my design students to ask why 5 times before they give up, but that's not easy to do. Now the curating part, when you have to create part of a data set. There's many ways to create interesting data sets. You have to create, you can wear an affectiva cufflink, which measures skin capacitance and tells you how emotional you are and how excited you are in different parts of your day. There's, of course, you could wear a Fitbit or an Apple Watch, these trackers that tell you how your heart rate is going. I personally like to wear a GoPro whenever possible. And I like to wear it on my head. I like to wear it on my leg sometimes. I like to wear it on my necklace as well. Just smile, right? But you could also go low tech and use one of these, excuse me, $60 audio recorders that I wear with me all the time. You see, for the past few months, in response to these videos and everything that's happening, I've been wearing an audio recorder all the time. To dinner, with friends, to class, when I'm making art, all the time. And it's been quite the experience to do that. I learned 3 main things while having an audio recorder on all the time. The first thing I learned was that I could really experience the moment better. I didn't have to remember or try to remember everything everybody was saying because I had it on the audio recorder. Instead, I could just enjoy myself in the moment and experience more in that moment. The second thing I learned was that some people really don't like to be recorded. They are scared to be caught saying something that they're not supposed to be saying. And the third thing I learned was that some people was the best security blanket for me. It meant that I didn't have to worry about, if you don't want me to know something that is secretive and I can't repeat it, then I would rather not know, or else I might forget it's a secret and tell somebody. So it was the cheapest form of security I've ever had. So my audio recorder became a sort of prosthetic for my brain. It was like a Fitbit, but for my brain, in that it allowed me to track and remember more, and so I could do more and connect more while I was in the moment. Let's go back to some clips of Savi and me drawing in my notebook. We did a couple of drawings that night. The first one was him with drawing a dinosaur. He loves dinosaurs. The second one was a death ship that was attacking the world, and he drew out the number 7 billion for the amount of people that were going to die because of the death ship. Then he asked me how many people live in Moscow because he's really excited about the World Cup in Russia, right? So we did the math for how many people live in Moscow. Then, this is the interpretive art. It says Savi there, right? It's an artistic rendering of his name. Then we started drawing, the app Duolingo, which he wants to use because he wants to learn Russian for the next World Cup, right? And so he finally was able to write the word Duolingo. Now we started drawing flags of countries. He loves flags. He's absolutely fascinated by flags. And so we started drawing pictures of his El Salvador, the country he's from. He even drew the flag of Brazil, which was great. And finally he drew this. And I said, Savi, what is that? And he said, oh, that's your country's flag. I said, Savi, what do you mean? I don't have a country. He said, yeah, if you had a country, the country's name would be Libra. And your flag would be this one, complementary colors, right? And I said, Savi, what? See, that doesn't make a lot of sense, except for the fact that I am born on October 11th, and in my zodiac sign, I am Libra. But Savi doesn't know that. I know that he has no way of knowing that. We've never talked about my birthday. That's what I call the brain making all kinds of wild connections. I want to get to the place where we can create process maps of all the connections our brains are making. Imagine if we could brain map the way that Savi was moving through the drawings, what he was drawing and when he was drawing it. And if we could talk match that with his speech and what he was telling us when he was speaking, how much better would we understand his brain? How much better could we understand autistic children's brains, and any children's brains for that matter? Because of examples like these, I want to propose the following. I want to curate together. I want us all to become con artists, leading the research happening all around us. All I'm saying is that if mother knows best, then let's turn that intuition into data. Let's make mothers the principal investigators of our research projects. I want us all to be agents of change. I'm proposing we build a community of researchers made up of everyday people like you and like me that share our data in order to answer some interesting why questions. This community would be on the internet, and it would be open sourced and crowdsourced. Here's how it works. You record something interesting, something you can't explain. So you decide, maybe the crowd can help. You post a short preview of the content on the forum, and then you offer a few why questions for your preview to get started. Why green and blue? Why Libra? Why the bee flipped the way it is, etc. Then you sit and you wait. It's open source, so lucky for you, the short preview can be seen by anybody in the world, maybe by some people that have similar questions like you. Eventually, somebody is going to propose something. Someone might have an idea for you. Someone might propose a plan to answer your question. Either way, you're the author of the data. You get to select to whom in the crowd you want to grant access to the full original data set. It's a platform where you celebrate and applaud the right questions, not necessarily the right answers. In short time, by granting access to your full data set, you will have enabled others to create connections based on your footage. And you may just learn a thing or two that you could not have otherwise known. Why do this, you ask? Because imagine what would happen if you could download someone else's experiences as a data set, whether they were in class, or over dinner with friends, or on the dance floor. Imagine if you could download 10 other people's experiences, or 100, or 1,000 other people's data sets. So, consider yourselves invited to be crowdsourced and to be open sourced. Join us as curators and as con artists, and let's ask why together. Thank you.